يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات والله بما تعملون خبير.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد. Today is our first lesson in which we're going to be taking the Kitab, Kitab al-Tawheed, in every Sunday in this masjid, inshallah, at 5 o'clock. Before we start going into the book, I want to make some introductory points about the masjid and also about the lesson, inshallah. The first point is that for those people who came on Friday, it's most of it repetition. First of all, this masjid is not yet open for salawat, 5 daily prayers. It's just been recently renovated. It's been a madrasa for Quran for the past 20 years. Last month was 10 years, but apparently it's 20 years. But for the past year, they've been renovated, alhamdulillah. And so it's about to open, inshallah ta'ala, very soon. So it's not open, but inshallah we're going to have our lessons here for Friday at 7 o'clock. In Matan al-Bishija, for those people who already came, we as a continuation for a lesson that we've been doing in Dar al Salam in North London and also in Masjid al Sunnah in North London. And so now we're going to continue that book, Matan al-Ghayat wa al-Taqrib, known as Matan al-Bishija. And we carried on from al-Buyu' transactions. For people who wasn't attending before, then يعني, it's going to be a bit harder for you to follow, but still beneficial, inshallah, if you want to come. But it's not necessarily يعني, the most beneficial thing for you, but it's still beneficial, inshallah ta'ala, if you haven't followed them before. Secondly, is that our lesson, this lesson on Sunday at 5 p.m., inshallah, is going to be in Kitab al-Tawheed. The way that we're going to be doing Kitab al-Tawheed is, inshallah, we're going to start from the beginning today. And the way that it's going to be explained is that if most people are familiar with يعني English, where you have like a point evident explanation, PEE, right? If you guys got that in school. The way it's going to be going, inshallah ta'ala, is that the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he brings a topic as a chapter. And so that topic is what he wants to explain. And then after that, he brings evidences he brings evidence for that point that he just made. So he makes a point, and then he gives you evidence, and then inshallah ta'ala we're going to be explaining it like that. Hopefully we're going to be finishing the book. It will take quite a long time probably. Inshallah, it will probably take quite a long time. And it is 64 chapters. The book is 64 chapters. Some of them are long, some of them are short. But it is one of the most important things that a person can do. The author, rahimahullah, wrote the book at a young age. And he wrote this book in the topic of Tawheed al-Ibadah, Tawheed of worship. That you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Why? Because he was at a time where people, they were worshipping graves and idols and other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we find that even today, where a person, he goes to a grave, or he goes to a shrine or somewhere like that, and they ask that person for help other than Allah. Or they go to a tree and they seek assistance from that tree, or a child from that tree. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. And so because of that, he came in a time where this was happening a lot in the Arabian Peninsula. In Arabia, I know today as places of Kuwait and Dubai and Qatar and Saudi Arabia. Those places, all of that, it was in the Arabian Peninsula. He came at that time, and during that time when they were doing a lot of that shirk, he came and he wrote books like this and other than this in order to explain to the people the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-Ibadah. And this is the reason why Allah created the human beings. So because of that, we're going to be going through this. It's one of the most important, no doubt, it is the most important topic that a person can learn. It is the most important topic that a person can learn. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتَ. that we have sent to every single ummah, every single nation, a messenger. And the message of this messenger was, أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهِ worship Allah alone. وَجِتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ and stay away from anything that is worshipped other than Allah. So because of that, also he started the book by mentioning Tawheed. What is the reality of Tawheed? Then he mentions after that the things that are they negate Tawheed. The things that negate Tawheed. So he starts with the actual explanation of what Tawheed is. Then the things that negate Tawheed from major shirk, and then he goes down to minor shirk, and then he goes down to things that go against the essence of Tawheed, but they're not necessarily major shirk or minor shirk, but rather they are sins that go against the person's Tawheed. So these are three points or that this book deals with. And if you see here in the book, you find that the author, rahimahullah, never brings or hardly ever, very, very, very little, throughout all of these 60 chapters, he never brings his own speech. He only brings the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes he brings the speech of some of the salaf, and once or twice I think he brings the speech of later generation scholars like Ibn Qayyim, Ibn Kathir and others. And maybe like once or twice he says something as a note himself. But generally it is all the Quran and the sunnah and according to the understanding of the sahaba. In order to do taqdeer of tawheed, yani to make people understand at tawheed. So therefore, if there's anything that needs to be asked, we'll start the book. The books also. The books that people registered, if you registered, you will know that you will have got a book, inshaAllah ta'ala. If there's anyone who registered and didn't get a book, if there is, then next week we're going to order it. Because we only ordered 40 from the brothers. 40 altogether for the brothers and sisters in English, and Arabic only 20. So I didn't know how many people were coming. Is any brothers who registered and didn't get it? Are there anyone? Or anyone who's going to be consistent and come and didn't get the book and need the book? One. Two, yeah? Did you register?
Yeah.
You asked for a book?
Yeah.
English?
Arabic.
Is Arabic left? It's Arabic, huh? You registered, yeah? Go the outside, the brother that did the Adhan Iqama, he will register your name. If your name's there, we'll get you.
You're right,
yeah? Yeah. Khalas, just tell him, go get the book, inshallah. Go get him, get now. The other brother, you register? Or is that the one? You register?
Yeah.
You wanted the book? You need the book?
Yeah, you said you ran out of English.
Finished? Okay, khalas, one, yeah? Tayyib. Next week, inshallah, shall I get for you. As for the sisters, then is there any sisters? And just, there's an organizer. And just put your hand up and they will count how many sisters need the book in English or Arabic if you register. Or the sisters, they have their books on their side. If there's any remaining, if there's no sisters that need the book and there's any remaining English books, then just bring it over, inshallah. Because we need one English book. But yeah. I don't know. Are you new? What is it? If you're in here, yeah. Oh, so there's no remaining book. No one needs a book, yeah? And they have that. Play it. Not everyone. Space out a bit. As much as you can. Even though it's fine. There's no space, and they can go upstairs. There's space upstairs. There's space in the office as well. They can come in the office as well. They can sit here. But there's space upstairs as well. طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يقول المصنف رحمه الله تعالى بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم كتاب التوحيد. So he says الحمد لله and الحمد لله. To explain it, because we explain a lot of times. Alhamd is to describe the one you are praising with the best of names and attributes. It is to describe the one you are describing with the best names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ma'al-hubbi wa ta'zeem, out of love and veneration of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is alhamd. Not necessarily just praise, it's to describe someone with the best of names and attributes. There's some space in the office. Go, sit over there. نعم مع الحب والتعظيم وصلى الله على عبد على محمد أن صلاة وسن صلاة على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم أن صلاة from Allah عز وجل to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. What does it mean? Does it mean salutations? Does it mean blessings? No, it doesn't. It means praising him, mentioning him amongst the highest angels. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention and praise the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam amongst the highest angels. That's what it means by salah on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa ala alihi, and upon his al. The al of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has two meanings. When someone says wa sallallahu ala Muhammad, ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi, it has two meanings. Number one is the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they are Banu Hashim and Banu Muttalib. And anyone who is from their lineage until today. The second meaning of Alihi is the followers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The followers. But that's only when the followers are not mentioned. But here he mentioned it. So therefore the intended meaning here is only the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ahlul Bayt. وعلى آله وصحبه and for his companions صلى الله عليه وسلم وسلم. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then يعني السلام, it is to negate any imperfections, negate any imperfections from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. كتاب التوحيد. So this is the first ترجمه, the first chapter that he mentioned, and we're going to get an idea of how the book's going to go. Inshallah ta'ala, after that, it will be the same throughout the whole book. Kitab al-Tawheed. Here, he has an intention behind what he's mentioning here. The author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he has an intention behind saying Kitab al-Tawheed. This chapter, he has a meaning. So he's trying to make a point here. And the point he's trying to make, he's going to back it up with evidences in the next, yani after that. Right? So what's the point that he's trying to make here, Kitab al-Tawheed? It is wujub al-tawheed, the obligation, right down. In this chapter, the author will prove the obligation of tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In it, he's going to prove the obligation that it is obligatory upon one of us to do tawheed, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Obligation of tawheed. What type of tawheed? At-tawheed fil ibadah, in worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why did you say we mean tawheed in ibadah and not in al-asma' al-sifat or al-rububiyyah? Why did you say tawheed fil ibadah, yeah?
Is it because even the mushrik in Quraysh, they affirmed Allah?
Ahsant, barakallahu feek. Even the mushrikeen of Quraysh, they affirmed the rububiyyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They affirmed that Allah is the one who created. So that's not what we're talking about here. Because the dispute between the Muslims and the non-Muslims isn't between if there is a creator or not, the majority of the non-Muslims. It's not that there is the dispute, is there a creator or one who provides for us? No. The dispute between the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the mushrikun was, is the creator, I mean, should we worship Allah alone? Worshipping Allah alone, that's the dispute. So therefore the author here, he establishes the obligation of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. That is the intended meaning behind this chapter. وَقَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. So he brings the evidences. He says, وَمَا خَلَقَتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Meaning he says, and I have not created the human beings, the jinn and the humans, إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, except to worship me. So what we're going to do here? We're going to look. Where is the point of evidence that he's trying to explain? Where is the point of evidence here? On obligation of tawheed. It is in two places in this ayah. Where is it? Who can say it? Illa liya'budun. Only to worship me, huh? That's one of the ways. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I have only created the human beings to worship me. Therefore it's obligatory to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And also the other way is the fact that Allah created you to do that. Therefore, tawheed is obligatory. I know this is the beginning, is basic, but the more yani, as they say, more yani, interesting, not interesting, but yani, more the things gonna, you guys are really going to pay attention to, inshallah, is going to come a bit later on, maybe in the end of this lesson and maybe the next lesson. So this lesson is going to be very, very basic. So do try to follow. وَمَا خَلَقَتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. We have not created the jinn and the human beings for anything other than worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because al-ibadah, whatever is mentioned in the Qur'an, it means al-tawheed. Ibadah meaning worship. He says ibadah, he says worship. Whenever the word ibadah or worship is mentioned in the Quran, it means a tawheed. Is it hot? You guys find it hot? It is a tawheed, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Because we couldn't receive one. إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما, he said, كُلُّ مَا وَرَدَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ مِنَ الْعِبَادَةِ فَمَعْنَاهُ التَّوْحِيدَ Everything that has been narrated in the Quran that means ibadah, says ibadah, whenever Allah says ibadah, like for example, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اُعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمْ Worship your Lord alone. يعني وَحِّدُوهُ تَوْحِيدَ بَاللَّهِ يعني worship him alone. That's Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه. That's a principle in the Quran, by the way. That whenever ibadah is mentioned, then it is mentioned by, it is intended by Tawheed. What dalil al-thani, the second evidence that he brings, look at it. He says, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنِ اعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ We have sent to every single nation a messenger, رَسُولًا. What was the message of this messenger? أَنِ اعْبُدُ اللَّهَ Worship Allah alone. وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ And stay away from anything that is worshipped other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? And this shows something, that the biggest command that Allah gave to us is at Tawheed, because every single messenger was sent with it. Every single messenger was sent with Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَنِ اعْبُدُ اللَّهِ Worship Allah alone. وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ And stay away from الطَّاغُوت. What is الطَّاغُوت? الطَّاغُوت is... Stay away from الطَّاغُوت. الطَّاغُوت is, write it down. كُلُّ مَا عُبِدَ Anything that is worshipped. Right? من دون الله besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is a tawhid. So anyone that's worshipped besides Allah, then is considered to be a tawhid, according to the one who's worshipping, of course. Right? يعني, the one who's doing the worship, to him that person is a tawhid, because he's worshipping him other than Allah. Then he says, with the thalith, this third evidence is, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهِ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا Allah says in the Quran that we have commanded قَضَى رَبُّكَ Your Lord has decreed. In Usul al-Fiqh you find that the word قَضَى when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He decreed something وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّهِ That you do not worship anyone except for Him. That you do not worship anyone except for Him. And so that's another evidence to show that it's Tawheed al-Ibadah. Ayah number 23 of Surah al-Isra. The fourth evidence is وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا Allah says in the Quran, this is Surah Al-Nisa. It is the ayah which is known as Surah Al-Nisa, ayah number 36. It is known as the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran. It says وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا وَاعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَبِذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَالْجَارِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْجَارِ ذِي الْجُنُبِ وَالصَّاحِبِ بِالْجَنْبِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ وَمَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ The 11 commands that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives in that ayah. And he starts it off with what? Worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. وَاعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا And that shows that the tawheed of Allah is the first command of Allah, so it's been commanded. And number two, it also shows that it is not only the command of Allah, but it's the biggest and the highest command of Allah. How do we see that? We see it in two ways. Number one, is that we see that Allah mentioned the ayah at the beginning, the first thing He mentioned is Tawheed of Allah. That shows that it's the biggest command of Allah. The second way that we see it is that every other commandment and prohibition comes after Tawheed. Because the waw is وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِشَيْئًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا All of them, waw, it comes after التوحيد. If anyone learning in Arabic, in Nahu, in Arabic grammar, you learn that the waw is for what? Al-Atf, right? Atf. And Atf means it is something that follows something else. And therefore, from this we understand that all of the commandments, they are followers of the original commandment of التوحيد. All commandments in Islam are an offshoot of the commandment of التوحيد. والدليل الخامس, the fifth evidence, he says, قل تعالوا أتل ما حرم ربكم عليكم. Come to me. Say, O يا رسول الله, the messenger of Allah. تعالوا come. أتل ما حرم ربكم عليكم. I will recite upon you what Allah has made haram upon you. In Surah Al-An'am, ayah number 151. He says, قُلْ تَعَالُوا أَتُوا مَا حَرَّمَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَيْكُمْ The first command is what? أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا Do you not worship anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا And that shows that a shirk is the biggest prohibition, the biggest sin that has been prohibited. The sixth evidence is what Dalil Sadis. This chapter is very long, so bear with us. Hadith ibn Abd ibn Mas'ud. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said, من أراد أن ينظر إلى وصية رسول. Sorry, the sixth evidence is نعم. Ibn Mas'ud. He said, من أراد أن ينظر إلى وصية محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم فليقرأ التي عليها خاتمه فليقرأ قوله تعالى قل تعالوا أتل ما حرم ربكم عليكم إلى قوله وأن هذا صراطي مستقيم فاتبعوه. Ibn Mas'ud رضي الله عنه. He said, whoever wants to see the wasiyya, the will that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left behind, that has his seal on it, يعني his stamp on it, فَلْيَقْرَأْ then read the Qur'an. Read this ayah in the Qur'an. And notice here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he never left a will behind when he was dying. He never left a will in terms of a written will, what should happen, how he should bear, all of that stuff, no. The will that he left behind was the Qur'an and the sunnah. That's the will of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Ibn Mas'ud, when he said, you want to see what the Prophet ﷺ commanded us to do, then read these ayat. قُلْ تَعَالَوْ أَتْلُ مَا حَرَّمَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَيْكُمْ. Come, I will recite upon you what Allah has made haram upon you. And the first thing he mentioned is, أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ مِنْ إِمْلَاقٍ نَحْنُ نَرُزُقُكُمْ وَإِيَّاهُمْ. And he mentioned the Lord of Commands. Until he says, وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوهُ. This is my path, which is مُسْتَقِيم, which is straight, فَاتَّبِعُوهُ, so follow it. The next evidence is, وَعَمْ مُعَاذِ بْنِ جَبَلٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ. فَمُعَاذِ بْنِ جَبَلٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالَ كُنْتُ رَدِيفَ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. I was a radif. I was sitting on a donkey with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. على حمار. On a donkey. فَقَالَ لِي, he said, يَا مُعَاذ, أو مُعَاذ. And Mu'adh ibn Jabal was from the scholars of the Sahaba. He was from the scholars of the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it shows that the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam would sometimes give knowledge to certain people and not to others. Why? Yani why would someone give knowledge to someone and not give it to another person? Not out of bad manners, not because of bad manners, but why? Exactly, because some people are more ready for it, more understanding. Yeah, and not everyone's able to get all the knowledge that you're able to give to them. Sometimes you're able to give someone some knowledge, and another person, if you said the same thing to him, he wouldn't understand it. He would understand it in a wrong way. So that's why you understand here that Mu'adh ibn Jabal, he was from the scholars of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he gave him some types of knowledge, or he taught him something that he didn't teach all of the companions. What is it? He says, Ya Mu'adh, O Mu'adh, أَتَدْرِي مَا حَقُّ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْعِبَادِ. Do you know what the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are upon the slaves? يعني, what right does Allah have upon us? What right does Allah have upon us? وَمَا حَقُّ الْعِبَادِ عَلَى اللَّهِ. And what is the rights of the slaves upon Allah? يعني, what rights do we have upon Allah? قُلْتُ, he said, اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَعْلَمُ. Allah and His Messenger knows this. قال, he said, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, حَقُّ الْعِبَادِ, حَقُّ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْعِبَادِ, the right of Allah upon His slaves, أَنْ يَعْبُدُوهُ وَلَا يُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا, that they worship Him alone and they do not associate any partners with Him. وَحَقُّ الْعِبَادِ عَلَى اللَّهِ. طيب, that's the rights of Allah upon His slaves, right? That we only worship Allah alone. What are our rights upon Allah? He says, وَحَقُّ الْعِبَادِ عَلَى اللَّهِ أَلَّا يُعَذِّبَ مَنْ لَا يُشْرِكُ بِهِ شَيْئًا, that he will not punish anyone who doesn't do shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a person doesn't do shirk, then know that he will enter into Jannah and he will not be punished. So Mu'adh, we were shocked about this knowledge. قلت, he said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَفَلَا أُبَشِّرُ النَّاسِ. Should I not tell the people about this? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا تبشرهم فيتكلوا. Do not tell them, so they become lazy. Yeah, do not tell them right now, at this time. And obviously Mu'adh, when he was dying, he said, if it wasn't for the fact that I was dying and I would be scared that I'm concealing some knowledge, I would never tell you this hadith. But because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is it some knowledge and I have to tell people, then he told the people when he was dying, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that passed away, right? And so that shows the how huge and how important the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, right? أخرجاه في الصحيحين. This hadith was narrated in Al-Bukhari Muslim in الصحيحين. The next thing that we also, that's the end of that chapter, but there's another thing, another element of this book that I didn't mention. So we have the point, we have the evidence, right? There's the evidences. And then we have an explanation, which the author even brings himself. But I'm going to explain to you some of the things that need to be explained as well. These are called the masail of the book now. So after every single chapter, what does he do? He brings the masail, the issues that are pertaining to that chapter that we spoke about. So we just spoke about that chapter. He's going to bring some benefits from each evidence. For example, he said, فيه مسائل. الأولى فاس مسألة الحكمة في خلق الجن والإنس. And these مسائل we're going to go through quickly. Just going to translate. They don't need much explanation. And you have actually the English doesn't have it. I think the Arabic has it. The English doesn't have it though. So we'll go through it quickly, inshallah ta'ala. And you benefit from it. Al-Ula, the first benefit is Al-Hikmatu fi khalq al-jinn wal-ins. The reason why the jinn and the human beings were created, which is to worship Allah alone. Second one is أن العبادة هي التوحيد لأن الخصومة فيه. Ibadah is tawheed. Because that is what the dispute between the prophets and the messengers and the people was in. And the people, to explain, to understand this more, when the prophets, they were sent to their people, they weren't sent to people who did not believe in a creator. They were never sent to the people, or hardly ever were they sent to the people who denied a creator. And the ones who denied a creator say that there is no creator, and the only reason why they would do so is out of arrogance. Right? So these people who the Prophet ﷺ was sent to, they acknowledged Allah as a creator. And they acknowledged the Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a creator and a provider. And they didn't think that these stones that they were worshipping other than Allah provided for them. And they didn't even believe that Jesus provides, some of them do. Like in generally, they didn't believe that the angels or the prophets, they provided for them, no. They believed that it was only Allah who created. What's the evidence for that? Allah says in the Quran, وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَهُمْ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. If you ask them, who created you? They're going to say Allah. The people, they're the mushrikun of Quraysh, right? A lot of people, they think that the mushrikun of Quraysh didn't believe in Allah. They didn't know who Allah was. They were like atheists. No. And even those who are claiming that they were God, like Fir'aun, Allah says about Fir'aun, وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا. He denied a creator. وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًا. But their own selves, they knew that there was a creator. Their own selves, they knew. Inside their own selves, they knew there was a creator, right? And Musa said to Fir'aun, قال لقد علمت ما أنزل هؤلاء إلا رب السماوات والأرض بصائر وإني لأظنك يا فرعون مخبورا. He said, you know that there was no one who sent down this book that I'm coming to you with except for رب السماوات والأرض, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the Lord of the heavens and the earth. So Musa is telling Fir'aun that you know that what I'm coming with is true. But what was his problem? He was arrogant. He didn't want to accept it. He didn't want to lose his power. And that's the problem of a lot of people. So the dispute between the prophets and the messengers and their people. Is there a red light still on? On top right? The dispute between the prophets and the people that they were sent with wasn't in Tawheed al-Ibadah, in worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Right? وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَن نَزَّلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً. If you ask them, who sent down from the heavens water? Who sends down the rain, يعني? They're going to say Allah. Allah said that in the Quran. Another place in the Quran, Surah Yunus. What does Allah say in Surah Yunus? فَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَسَخَّرَ الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. If you ask them, who created the heavens and the earth, who created them? And who used the one, سَخَّرَ الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ, who subjugated the sun and the moon? يعني who makes the sun and the moon move? لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. They'll say Allah. So they acknowledge all of it. They ask them, who provided for you? Who gave it? They'll say Allah. So why did they worship other than Allah? They would only worship other than Allah because they thought that these people that they're worshipping are closer to them than Allah, are closer to Allah than them. And they say that this one is closer to Allah than me, so I'm going to go through him to get to Allah. I can't go straight to the Allah. And they bring the and even the mushrikeen of today, they say, can you go directly to the boss of the company? No, you have to go through your secretary, right? That's what the argument is today. And they're trying to compare Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the boss of the company. So they say, we have to go to them. So they say, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ in the Quran, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفًا. We don't worship them except to bring us closer to Allah. That's what the mushrikun of Quraysh said, right? So they believed in that. So the reason why they used to worship other than Allah was to get closer to Allah. So therefore, that is what the message of the messengers was. Was what? Leave off these things that you're worshipping other than Allah and worship the one who created you. That's why Allah all the time, He uses the argument of the fact that He created in order to establish the fact that He is the one who deserves to be worshipped alone. He uses the argument that He is the one who created alone. And they accept that, they agree with that, to show that we should worship Him alone as well. Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nas, O mankind, U'budu rabbakum, worship your Lord. Why? الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ The one who created you and the one who created those before you so that you may have taqwa. So look, notice how Allah commanded us to worship Him alone. Why? Because He's only created. And this is not something that they deny. But their problem was what? We want to worship other than Allah so we can get closer to Allah. Allah says about that in the Quran, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ يَبْتَغُونَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمُ الْوَسِيلَةِ أَيُّهُمْ أَقْرَبُ وَيَرُجُونَ رَحْمَتَهُ وَيَخَافُونَ عَذَابَهُ Those people who you worship other than Allah, they are the same people who themselves are trying to get closer to Allah. So how are you going to use them to get closer to Allah? أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ يَبْتَغُونَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمُ الْوَسِيلَةِ أَيُّهُمْ أَقْرَبُ وَيَرُجُونَ رَحْمَتَهُ They're hoping for the mercy of Allah. وَيَخَافُونَ عَذَابَهُ And they themselves fear the punishment of Allah. Does the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, does he not fear the punishment of Allah? Of course he does. أنا, he says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أنا أتقاكم لله. أنا أعلمكم بالله وأتقاكم له. I'm the one who's the most knowledgeable of Allah, and I'm the one who fears Him the most. Did he not fear Allah? He had the most taqwa, right? But the point is that he's trying to make it back. These people that they worship other than Allah, this is a common mistake amongst Muslims today, that they thought that these people, they used to worship them because they believe that they are the creator. No, they didn't believe that. They didn't believe that this stone created heaven and earth. Even the Hindus today don't believe that. If you ask the Hindu, why do you worship this? What was he going to say? He's not going to say because the stone created it. He knows that he made the stone yesterday. He knows when he made it. Right? But what? He says, this person went either, they say one of two. They say either, I'm worshipping him because it gets me, it makes me focus on him. Because the person is a righteous person, so it reminds me of Allah, and so I can worship Allah better. Or they say, when I worship this stone, Allah sends the soul of that person that I'm worshipping to the stone, and he talks to me. And who is that thing that's talking to them? Shaytan, jinn. That's why in the Quran, Allah says in the Quran, وَيَوْمَ يَحْشُرُهُمْ جَمِيعًا ثُمَّ يَقُولُ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ On the day when they resurrect all of them, and Allah is going to say to the angels, أَهَؤُلَاءِ إِيَّاكُمْ كَانُوا يَعْبُدُونَ Did they used to worship you? The people they used to claim worshiping the angels. They have a picture of an angel, they worship the angel. And the angel is speaking. What's the angel going to say? قَالُوا سُبْحَانَكَ مَا أَهَؤُلَاءِ إِيَّاكُمْ كَانُوا يَعْبُدُونَ قَالُوا هؤلاء إياكم كانوا يعبدون قالوا سبحانك أنت ولينا من دونهم The jinn themselves, the angels themselves are going to say أنت ولينا من دونهم You're the one who are, you're our helper besides them يعني we worship you alone, the angels are going to say بل كانوا يعبدون الجن Rather they used to worship the jinn Why? Because the jinn, the shaytan would come into that statue and talk to them And they used to worship the jinn and they used to think it's the angel. The point is, they never thought that this stone created other than Allah. So, therefore, they used to say, they were shocked when the Prophet ﷺ came and he says, أَجَعَلُ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَاهًا وَاحِدًا إِنَّ هَذَا لَشَيْءٌ عَجَابٌ Did they make all of these gods that we worship, they make them one god? Something that's changed. We worship all of these gods, trying to make them one worship one. How are we going to get closer to Allah then? They never believed. So, guys, the point is here. They never believed in these things created other than Allah. What they believed in is what? That these things, they're going to get them closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the shirk that the Prophet came to destroy. Right? So number two, Hazrat, أَنَّ الْعِبَادَةَ هِيَ التَّوْحِيدِ Worship is Tawheed. لِأَنَّ الْخُصُومَةَ فِيهِ Because the dispute is here. This is where the dispute between us and the non-Muslims is worshiping other than Allah. Worship Allah alone. Okay? As for the Rububiyyah, then generally, even the Mushrikun, even today, they believe that only Allah is the one who created. But today it's got worse. Allah musta'an. Some people they actually believe that. Some people they worship, they have ability to help themselves, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and things like that. Al-Thalitha. Number three is, أَنَّ مَنْ لَمْ يَأْتِهِ لَمْ يَعْبُدِ اللَّهِ Whoever does not come with Tawheed, then he hasn't worshipped Allah. What point is he trying to make here? So I'm going slowly, but I have to make the instruction point. So you have to understand these points in order to understand the rest of the book. أن من لم يأتي به لم يعبد الله ففيه معنى قوله ولا أنتم عابدون ما أعبد. توحيد to worship is like wudu to salah. توحيد to worship is like wudu to salah. Rather than توحيد to worship is like الوضوء to salah. What's that mean? If a person he gets up and he does 4 rak'ah without wudu and he knew he didn't have wudu, is that called salah? It's not called salah, right? It's just movement. It's not called salah. Just movement and words. Because he knew he didn't have wudu and he didn't do wudu. Right? It's just movement. طيب. If a person worships other than Allah, he does shirk, he doesn't have tawheed, but he gives charity. And he does charity for the sake of God, for Allah. But he's doing shirk on the side. Is that charity considered to be a charity for the sake of Allah? No, it's not. Because there is no wudu, there is no tawheed. You understand? It's a condition for your act to be worshipped, your act of worship to be worshipped, and your act of worship to be accepted, that you have tawheed in it. طيب, look at this. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا عَابِدُونَ. In it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا عَابِدُونَ. In Surah Al-Kafirun, right? What's the reason why Surah Al-Kafirun was revealed? Surah Al-Kafirun was revealed when a group of mushrikun, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they said, Oh Muhammad, let's have a deal here. 1 year, we're going to worship Allah alone. And we worship Allah alone with you. And the next year, we're going to worship our idols and you can worship our idols alone. So do it. Look, if that happened, they worshiped Allah alone in 1 year, would that be considered to worship Allah? No, it wouldn't. Because they're still mushrikeen, right? That's what Allah says. وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ. You're not going to worship what I worship. Even if you do that deal, 1 year, you're worshiping Allah alone that year. It's not considered to be ibadah. Why? Because you're still worshiping Him. You still do shirk for Allah. You understand? Is that clear, guys? Is that clear? Is it not clear to anyone? واضح. Alhamdulillah. طيب. So that is الرابعة لحكمة في رسالة الرسل. The fourth benefit is the wisdom behind sending the messengers. Number 5 is أن الرسالة عمت كل أمة. This message of Tawheed was sent to all of the nations. السادسة أن دين الأنبياء واحد. That the religion of the prophets is one. As opposed to what we say, that the religion of Abrahamic faith. They're all three faiths, they're all allowed. لا. The religion of the prophets are all Islam. إن الدين عند الله Islam. إن ما كان إبراهيم يهوديا ولا نصرانيا ولكن كان حنيفا مسلما. Ibrahim was not a Yahudi. He was not a Christian, but he was a Muslim. نعم. Was the answer that?
No.
Why?
They have
a whole tawheed. That's the whole point I'm trying to make. These people, they're not considered, even that 1 year, they're not considered to be muwahhidin, people of tawheed. Because they still have that shirk in them. They believe that they're going to be shirk next year. They still have that shirk. So they haven't, it's like I don't have a wudu. You say, I'm going to pray Salah every five times a day, but I'm never going to do wudu. I'm going to do wudu next year. Or you can go down, I'm going to be wet. No, I'm never going to be there. طيب. The Salah is never going to be there. Did you get it?
Doesn't?
Like if you pray with wudu 1 year. No, sorry. I made a wrong example. يعني, it's like praying without wudu. Say someone says, I'm going to pray 1 year, and 1 year I'm not going to pray, but he never does wudu. That makes it clear, huh? يعني, someone says, I'm going to pray 1 year, I'm not going to pray the other year, but I'm never going to do wudu. He doesn't have wudu anymore. You have to come to Eid for it to be accepted. JazakAllah khair. طيب السادسة أن دين الأنبياء واحد. السابعة المسألة الكبيرة. Seven one is a huge مسألة, which is أن عبادة الله لا تحصل إلا بالكفر بالطاغوت. That worship of Allah is never actualized except by disbelieving in الطاغوت. Anything that is worshipped other than Allah. ففيه معنى قوله تعالى فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى. So whoever believes in الطاغوت, so whoever disbelieves in الطاغوت and believes in Allah, then he has held on to the firm rope. الثامنة أن الطاغوت عام في كل ما عبد من دون الله. The next benefit is that الطاغوت is anything that is worshipped other than Allah. التاسعة عظم شأن ثلاث الآيات المحكمات في سورة الأنعام عند السلف. How great these ayat, that the Salaf, how they took these ayat. Which ayat am I talking about in Surah Al-An'am? قل تعالوا أتل ما حرم ربكم عليكم. The one that Ibn Mas'ud referred to in the evidence. So go back to that. That's right. The one Ibn Mas'ud mentioned basically. التاسع العاشرة الآيات المحكمات في سورة الإسراء. The آيات in سورة الإسراء. They start off with التوحيد. الحادية عشر 11. The آيات of سورة النساء. Again they start off with التوحيد. الثانية عشرة التنبيه على وصية رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عند موته. The وصية, the will of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was to worship Allah alone. ثالثة عشرة 13. معرفة حق الله علينا. We know the rights of Allah upon us. الرابعة عشرة 14 is معرفة حق العباد عليه إذا أدوا حقه. What are the rights of Allah if we give His rights? What are the rights of us, our rights, if we give Allah His rights? He doesn't punish us if we worship Him alone. حسنتم. الخامسة عشرة أن هذه المسألة لا يعرفها أكثر الصحابة. This مسألة لا يعرفها الصحابة إلا نوبة. What's the name of Allah? التوحيد؟ صحابة لأنه التوحيد؟ ما هو ذلك؟ ها؟ الحديث مع الكومس الله يعني. نعم. السادسة عشرة جواز كتمان العلم للمصلحة. 16 is the permissibility of holding back knowledge and not giving someone knowledge if there's a benefit. Right? If there's a benefit, then you don't give someone a certain type of knowledge because there's a benefit behind it. السابعة عشرة 17 is استحباب بشارة المسلم بما يسره. That you should give good news to the Muslim with something that pleases him. يعني it's good to do that. الثامنة عشرة الخوف من الاتكال على سعة رحمة الله. That you should be scared to rely on the mercy of Allah. يعني if you only rely on the mercy of Allah, you don't fear Allah at all. That's a scary position that you're in. التاسعة عشرة قول المسؤول عما لا يعلم الله ورسوله أعلم. If a person doesn't know something, you should say الله ورسوله أعلم. Can you say Allah wa Rasuluhu A'lam today? You are not allowed to say Allah wa Rasuluhu A'lam when it comes to things in the unseen of the world. يعني you say only Allah wa A'lam. For example, is it going to rain tomorrow? Can you say Allah wa Rasuluhu A'lam? Allah, the messenger knows best? No. Allah, only Allah knows. طيب, but if someone asks what's the rule of praying, 5 daily prayers, you say Allah wa Rasuluhu A'lam, can you? Yes, you can, because the Prophet Allah from Jesus. طيب, so in the أحكام الشريعة you can say Allah wa Rasuluhu A'lam, and the أحكام الكونية, and the worldly things, future and things like that, only Allah knows. التاسعة عشرة قول المسؤول عما لا يعلم. العشرون جواز تخصيص بعض الناس بالعلم دون بعض. You're allowed to give some people certain knowledge and not give other people. الحادية والعشرون 21 is تواضعه صلى الله عليه وسلم. The humbleness of the Prophet, humility of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, that he would ride upon a donkey with someone behind him, and he was the leader of Muslims at the time. ثانية والعشرون 22 جواز الإرداف على الدابة. You're allowed to have two people on one donkey. And some people might say he might be harming the donkey. No, Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم done it. Therefore, you're allowed to do it. الثالثة والعشرون عظم شأن هذه المسألة. How big this مسألة is. الرابعة والعشرون فضيلة معاذ الجبل. The virtue of معاذ ابن جبل. نعم. That is the first chapter. So that's how that chapter is very long. Most chapters are not like that, and most chapters are new concepts. Most of that wasn't new concepts. Most chapters are going to be new concepts, inshallah ta'ala, after that. So let's carry on this chapter. نعم. فضل التوحيد وما يكفر من الذنوب. The point that he's trying to make here, write down. The virtue of tawheed. The virtue of tawheed. The benefit of a person having tawheed. وَمَا يُكَفِّرُ مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ. And this can have one of two meaning. وَمَا يُكَفِّرُ مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ. This means the virtue of Tawheed. And what sins it expiate? What sins of Tawheed expiate? يعني take away. Or it can mean the virtue of Tawheed and the fact that it expiates sins. Because the ma'a yakfi musula or يعني either way doesn't make too much of a difference. But it's a benefit in Arabic. It's not a good point. Don't worry, you can understand that. طيب, virtue of tawheed. Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It says, وَقَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. Allah says in the Quran, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمِ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. Those people who believe in Allah and they do not coat their iman with ظلم, with oppression. أولئك لهم الأمن وهم مهتدون. Those people are the ones who have safety and they are the ones who will be guided. What does it mean here? Allah says in the Quran, those people who have tawheed, they worship Allah alone. Amir, amana, they have iman. And they do not quote this iman bi dhulm. What's dhulm here? It is? Shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is shirk. The Sahaba, Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhuma, radiallahu anhu, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, وَأَيُّنَا لَا يَظْلِمُ نَفْسَهُ. Who from amongst us doesn't oppress himself? Because the word dhulm here means oppressing. And it can mean sin. So the companions, when they heard this ayah, they said, only those people who don't oppress themselves, and do not sin, that's what they understood from it. Right? And so he said, أَيُّنَا لَا يَظْلِمُ نَفْسَهُ. Who from amongst us doesn't oppress himself? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, that's not the dhulm that he's talking about in this ayah. أَلَمْ تَسْمَعْ قَوْلَ الْعَبْدِ الصَّالِحِ. Have you not heard the speech of the righteous slave, Luqman, when he said, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Shirk is a huge dhulm, huge oppression. Yani, the thing that's been talking about, the dhulm here, the oppression that's being spoken about in this ayah is الشِّرْكُ بِاللَّهِ. So those people who have iman in Allah, they have tawheed, and they do not quote their tawheed in shirk, and they don't do shirk with Allah. What's their reward? The virtue of tawheed, huh? See the point of the chapter. What's their reward? أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ. They have al-amn, they have safety. وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. They'll be guided. Ibn Jarir in al-Tabari, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions in his tafsir, أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. They are guided, يعني they will be safe on the day of judgment, and they will be guided in this dunya to the good deeds. يعني they will be good, they will be guided in this dunya to good deeds. Write down, huh? أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ الْأَمْرُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. They have safety on the يوم القيامة, on the day of judgment, and they will be rightly guided on in this dunya. And that is in accordance to the power and how strong tawheed is in the person's heart. The more, the stronger the tawheed is in that person's heart, the more they will be given the guidance to be doing good deeds and slaying wicked sins, and the more they will be given safety on the day of judgment. And that's from the biggest يعني benefits of the tawheed. وعن عبادة بن الصامت رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من شهد أن لا إله إلا الله. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, من شهد أن لا إله إلا الله. Whoever bears witness that there is nothing worthy of worship except for Allah. وحده لا شريك له. Him alone, and there is nothing worthy of worship other than Him. وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his slave and his messenger. وأن عيسى عبد الله ورسوله. And Isa, Jesus, is the slave of Allah and his messenger. وكلمته ألقاها إلى مريم. And he is the speech of Allah that was thrown into Maryam. يعني, what does it mean, the speech of Allah? Meaning he was created by the speech of Allah. Meaning he was created by the speech of Allah. يعني, what was the speech of Allah that he created him with? كن, right? فيكون, كن. وكلمته ألقاها إلى مريم. وروح منه, and he is a soul from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And his soul is blown into Maryam from Allah. والجنة حق, and Jannah is the truth. والنار حق, and the hellfire is the truth. What's the reward for this person? أدخله الله الجنة على ما كان من العمل. Allah will enter him into Jannah despite any deed that he does. No matter what sin that person does, he will enter into Jannah if he worships Allah alone. Right? And that is for the one, there's two types of people who enter into Jannah. One who enter into Jannah straight away, without any punishment, he won't enter the hellfire. That's the one whose good deeds are more than his bad deeds. As for the one that his bad deeds are more than his good deeds, then if Allah doesn't enter him into Jannah, then he will enter into the hellfire, and then he will be taken out, and then he will enter into Jannah. Either way, anyone of tawheed, any person of tawheed who worships Allah alone, he will enter into Jannah eventually. Narrated by Al-Bukhari Muslim. وَلَهُمَا فِي حَدِيثِ عِتْبَانِ. In the hadith of Itban, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَ عَلَى النَّارِ مَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Allah has made haram the hellfire on anyone who says لا إله إلا الله. يَبْتَغِي بِذَلِكَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ, whilst he seeks the face of Allah with that. He says لا إله إلا الله, seeking the pleasure of Allah, Allah has made the hellfire haram upon that person. وَعَنْ أَبِي سَعِيدٍ الْخُدْرِيِّ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ. عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, narrated from Abu Sa'id al-Khudri رضي الله عنه, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, قال موسى, موسى said, عليه السلام, the Prophet موسى, he said, يا رب, oh my Lord, علمني شيئا أذكرك وأدعوك به. Teach me something that I can remember you with, and I can call you with. قال قل يا موسى, Allah said to Musa, O Musa, say لا إله إلا الله. He said, O Musa, say there is nothing, لا إله إلا الله, there is nothing worthy of worship except Allah. قال موسى, Musa said, كل عبادك يقولون هذا. All of your slaves are saying this. Everyone says لا إله إلا الله. Musa wants something specific for himself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches the Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam about the great weight of this word لا إله إلا الله. قال يا موسى, O Musa, لو أن السماوات السبع, if the seven heavens وعامرهن غيري, and everyone, all of those who look after the seven heavens, angels, other than me, غيري, والأراضين السبع, and the seven earths, في كفة, they were on one side of the scale. So imagine the seven heavens, the universe, everything above it, and the sun and the moon and the earth, and all of that was on one scale. All of that with them. وَلَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ فِي كِفَّةٍ, and لا إله إلا الله is in another side of the scale. He said, مَالَتْ بِهِنَّ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ will outweight heaven and earth. And that shows that how powerful this word is. رواه ابن حبان والحاكم وصححه. It's written by ابن حبان الحاكم, and he said this from 30 حديث. وللتلمذي وحسنه. الترمذي narrated and he said this حديث حسن عن أنس, from Anas ibn Malik. قال he said, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول, I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم say, قال الله تعالى, Allah said, يعني حديث إلهي, من حديث from the speech of Allah, يا ابن آدم إنك لو أتيتني بقراب الأرض خطايا ثم لقيتني لا تشرك بي شيئا, if you come to me with the earth full of sins, يعني you come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the earth full of sins, then you meet Allah, لا تشرك به شيئا, you're not worshipping anything other than Allah, لأتيتك بقرابها مغفرة, I will come to you with the earth full of forgiveness. And again, that's from the virtues of التوحيد of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. سيسا فيه المسائل الأولى سعة فضل الله. This is how wide the mercy of Allah, the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. ثانية كثرة ثواب التوحيد عند الله. How much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how big the reward of tawheed is with Allah. That's a big reward. الثالثة, the third thing is تكفيره مع ذلك للذنوب. Not only is it a big, huge good deed, because we saw how heavy it is on the scale of the day of judgment, but not only that, but it's also something that forgives the sins as well. It takes away your sins. الرابعة تفسير الآية التي في سورة الأنعام. The tafsir of the ayah that is in سورة الأنعام. الخامسة يعني سورة الأنعام, the first ayah they mentioned it, right? نعم الذين آمنوا لم يلبسوا إيمانهم بظلم. So people who don't quote their إيمان بظلم, يعني شرك. الخامسة number five is تأمل الخمسة اللواتي في حديث عبادة. Those five things that were mentioned in the hadith of عبادة, that Allah, the worship of Allah alone, لا إله إلا الله, Muhammad the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, Isa is the speech of Allah, and Jannah is true, and the hellfire is true. Think about these things. السادس أنك إذا جمعت بينه وبين حديث عتبان وما بعده تبين لك معنى قول لا إله إلا الله وتبين لك خطأ المغرورين. If you think about this now, if you think about what I mentioned there, and he's mentioned the next hadith, the hadith of عتبان. So he mentioned those five things. You worship Allah alone, you say لا إله إلا الله, and the Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is the messenger of Allah, and the Isa is the messenger and the slave of Allah, and the Jannah and the hellfire is the truth. And what was the addition in the hadith of عتبان? What's the addition? لا, what's the addition of hadith عتبان? يَبْتَغِي بِذَلِكَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ. He seeks the help of Allah, he seeks the face of Allah. يعني you do this seeking the face of Allah. You see, when you understand these things, you understand the mistake of those people who are deluded. People are deluded about لا إله إلا الله. Why? Because they believe that just because you say لا إله إلا الله and you don't act by it, you enter into Jannah. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, hey, he said, what? Are these five things, you believe in it. The Prophet, the Jannah is the truth and the hellfire is the truth, and you seek the face of Allah. يعني it entails actions. It entails your actions. تبين لك خطأ المغرورين. You see the mistake of those people who are deluded about the Tawheed. They think it's just a word. Okay? And they were all Muslims because they all say لا إله إلا الله, even if they worship other than Allah سبحانه وتعالى. السابعة التنبيه للشرط الذي في حديث عتبان. Look at the condition in the hadith of عتبان, which is what? What is it? يبتغي بذلك وجه الله. You're only seeking the help of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. الثامنة كون الأنبياء يحتاجون للتنبيه على فضل لا إله إلا الله. That even the prophets, they were given a reminder of the virtue of لا إله إلا الله. تاسعة التنبيه لرجحانها بجميع المخلوقات مع أن كثيرا مما يقولها يخف ميزانه. You see that the لا إله إلا الله, it is stronger and it's heavier than all of the creations. But many of those people who say it, their weight on their judgment is still going to be light. Why? Because they didn't actualize Tawheed properly. العاشرة النص على أن الأراضين السبع كسماوات, the seven earths just like seven heavens. الحادية عشرة أن لهن عمارة, that they are angels to look after it. الثانية عشرة إثبات الصفات خلافا للأشعرية, that we affirm the صفات, the attributes of Allah, as opposed to the أشعرية, we don't affirm the صفات of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. ثالثة عشرة أنك إذا عرفت حديث أنس وعرفت أن قوله في حديث عتبان فإن الله حرم على النار من قال لا إله إلا الله يبتغي بذلك وجه الله, أن ترك الشرك ليس قولها باللسان. Leaving of shirk doesn't mean that just by saying. يعني leaving of shirk is not just saying I don't do shirk. الرابعة عشرة تأمل جميع الجمع بين كون عيسى ومحمد عبدي الله ورسوليه. That you have to think about the fact that Muhammad and Isa, they both, you have to believe that they're slaves of Allah and the Messenger. يعني don't worship Isa other than Allah. الخامسة عشرة معرفة اختصاص عيسى بكونه كلمة الله. Isa is the speech of Allah. السادسة عشرة معرفة كونه روحا من, that is a soul from Allah سبحانه وتعالى. سابعة عشرة معرفة فضل الإيمان بالجنة والنار, the virtue of having إيمان الجنة and hellfire. الثامنة عشرة معنى قوله على ما كان من العمل, that you understand that what it means by despite whatever you do, يعني as long as you don't do shirk, يعني وأنت في الجنة as long as you don't do shirk. التاسعة عشر معرفة أن الميزان له كفتان, that the ميزان has two sides, the scale on day of judgment, as opposed to the, some groups, deviated groups who don't believe in it, there's no scale on day of judgment, and they say why does Allah need a scale. مع العشرون معرفة ذكر الوجه, that Allah سبحانه وتعالى has a face. The next chapter is من حقق التوحيد دخل الجنة بغير حساب ولا عذاب. If you guys want to take a break and we'll carry on until after Maghrib, during Maghrib, sorry, yeah, 15 minute break, stand up. There's no internet here, maybe some of your parents are calling, I don't know. We'll take a break until, and we'll carry on until Maghrib, or you just carry on for another 20 minutes? We should take a break. Carry on. Huh? Some people can't sit down for that long, that's nice. Carry on and take a break for 10 to 15 minutes? Or do you want to carry on for 10 to 20, 30 minutes? Carry on, huh? No one wants to take a break? Only one person, sorry. And there's some people are shy. You can take a break. Break is good. I don't mind. طيب نوع الحمد لله. باب من دخل من حقق التوحيد دخل الجنة بغير حساب ولا عذاب. Now the one who actualizes التوحيد, he enters into Jannah without any accountability. What is this chapter? What is the point of this chapter? The point of this chapter is to show that the one who actualizes التوحيد, he will enter into Jannah without any accountability, nor any punishment. يعني if a person actualizes Tawheed, we're going to explain what actualizes Tawheed means inshallah, then that person, he will enter into Jannah on the Day of Judgment, and he will come on the Day of Judgment and Allah is not going to ask him any questions. يعني no حساب, no accountability for your actions, straight into Jannah. ولا عذاب, and he will not be punished. What do you mean by actualizing Tawheed? Actualizing Tawheed is three things. That person, he leaves off a shirk, worshiping other than Allah. Worshiping Allah, so he leaves the shirk. Number two is, he leaves us bid'ah, innovation. And number three is, he leaves off sins. Doesn't do sins. يعني, and if he doesn't do a sin, he repents, because everyone does sins. But if he does sins, he repents. And that shows that anyone who actualizes Tawheed, they will enter into Jannah without any accountability, nor any punishment, and we have the evidences for that here, inshallah. Allah says in the Quran, وَقَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ كَانَ أُمَّةً قَانِتًا لِلَّهِ حَنِيفًا وَلَمْ يَكُ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ That Ibrahim, he was an ummah. قَانِتًا لِلَّهِ Obedient to Allah. What does it mean by ummah? يعني he was an imam. The word ummah in the Quran has many different meanings. When it's talking about Ibrahim here, it means he was an imam, ummah. Ummah has another meaning, for example, ummah as a nation, right? كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس. Also it means religion. إنا وجدنا آباءنا على أمة وإنا على آثارهم مقتدون. We found our fathers on أمة. يعني on religion. It has different meanings in the Quran. Right? And here it means imam. إن إبراهيم كان أمة يعني إماما. Ibrahim was an imam. قانتا لله. He was obedient to Allah. حنيفا. He was upon Al-Hanifiyya. What is Al-Hanifiyya? Al-Hanifiyya is the religion of Al-Tawheed. What it means is for a person, يَمِيلُ عَمَّا سِوَى Sorry. It means to face towards Al-Tawheed, Al-Iqbal. Al-Hanifiyya means Al-Iqbal, to face towards something. مَائِلٌ أَنِ الشِّرْكِ And you're staying away from shirk. That's what it means. It's to face towards something and to face away from something else. يعني, you're facing towards the Tawheed alone and you're facing away from shirk. يعني, he was a person of Tawheed. وَلَمْ يَكُ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ And he was not from the Mushrikeen. Ibrahim was not from the Mushrikeen. طيب, where does it say, where's the point of the chapter here? In this ayah? He's going to went into Jannah without any accountability or any punishment. Where is that in this ayah? Where? Okay, let me come. Okay, he wasn't in the ship, but where is it? He's going to enter Jannah without any accountability.
He was by himself.
He was. That's true, but I don't know if I can enter into Jannah without any accountability. Let me tell you. The author, he sometimes, what he does, out of good thoughts of the one who's reading the book, he assumes that you've already memorized the Quran. Okay? So as a student of knowledge, you should have memorized the Quran, the whole Quran. Because the author, that's what he assumes. Because the point of this ayah, or the point of evidence that he's trying to bring, is not in this ayah, it's in the next ayah. إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ كَانَ أُمَّةً قَانِتًا لِلَّهِ حَنِيفًا وَلَمْ يَكُمْ لِلْمُشْرِكِينَ شَاكِرًا لِأَنْعُمِهِ اجْتَبَاهُ وَهَدَاهُ إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ And the next ayah, وَآتِيْنَاهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَإِنَّهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ لَمِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ In the Akhirah, he's going to be from the صالحين, يعني those who will not be held accountable for anything. That's what it shows the ayah. So the author, he assumes that you remember the Quran as a student of knowledge. And that's a tanbih for you, brothers and sisters, is that we should all memorize. Obviously, most people, even if you memorize the Quran, you still probably would have got that because you think, well, you're looking at this ayah, you're supposed to look at the next two ayahs. But la ba's. The point is that he, you know, as a student of knowledge, it is one of the most important things for a person to memorize the Quran. Memorizing the Quran is the difference between, in many a times, is the difference between a person who actually seriously is going to study the religion of Allah and يعني, be successful in it, and the one who's not going to be doing that. طيب. So memorizing the Quran is very important. وقال, the next evidence is وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِرَبِّهِمْ لَا يُشْرِكُونَ Those who do not do shirk with Allah. This ayah, again, he hasn't mentioned it here. He mentioned it before and after. The Surah Al-Mu'minun, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ هُمْ مِنْ خَشْيَةِ رَبِّهِمْ مُشْفِقُونَ He describes some of the believers. إن الذين هم من خشية ربهم مشفقون والذين هم بآيات ربهم يؤمنون والذين هم بربهم لا يشركون والذين يؤتون ما آتوا وقلوبهم وجلة أنهم إلى ربهم راجعون أولئك يسارعون في الخيرات وهم لها سابقون Those who they only worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He describes some of the characteristics of these believers, right? And he says, أولئك يسارعون في الخيرات. Those are the ones who are going to be doing good in this dunya. وَهُمْ لَهَا سَابِقُونَ After describing him, yani. They don't do shirk. And in the act, and they're going to be سَابِقُونَ They're going to be the first, yani the first group of people. What does it mean by being the first group of people? meaning they're going to be the first group of people to do good in this dunya, therefore they are going to be the first group of people to enter into Jannah in the Akhirah, and they are the ones who enter into Jannah without any accountability or any punishment. Is that clear? Yeah, and they rush towards good in the dunya, therefore they will be rushed towards the good in the Akhirah. They rush towards good in the dunya, therefore they will be rushed towards the good in the Akhirah, يعني Jannah, بغير حساب ولا عذاب. Then he says, وعن حسين بن عبد الرحمن قال كنت عند سعيد بن جبير. This is a long story. حسين بن عبد الرحمن, one of the أتباع التابعين, all the تابعين, he says, كنت عند سعيد بن جبير. He was with سعيد بن جبير. سعيد بن جبير was from the companions of Ibn Abbas, one of the great مفسرون of the Quran, who do تفسير of the Quran. فقال سعيد بن جبير, he said, أيكم رأى الكوكب الذي انقض البارحة؟ Which one of you saw the star, the shooting star yesterday? Shooting star yesterday. فقلت أنا, but me, I saw it and I saw the shooting star. ثم قلت, but I said, أما وإني لم أكن في صلاة, but I wasn't praying at night. يعني last night, you saw the star at night. Me, I saw it, but I wasn't praying at night. I wasn't awake. ولكن إني لدغ. The reason why I saw it, the reason I was awake at that time is because I was stung by a scorpion. قال فما صنعت. He said, what did you do about getting stung? You got stung. What did you do about that? قلت, he said, ارتقيت. I don't ruqya on myself. قال, he said, فما حملك على ذلك? Why did you do that? Why did you do ruqya on yourself when you got stung? قلت, he said, حديث حدثني به شعبي. He said, a hadith that I was told about by شعبي. شعبي is عامر بن شراهيل. الشعبي, one of the great تابعين in hadith. One of the hadith at the time of the students of the companions. قال, وما حدثكم? He said, what did الشعبي tell you? قال, قلت, he said, قال حدثنا عن بريدة بن الحصيب. From بريدة بن الحصيب, أنه قال, he said, لا رقية إلا من عين أو حمى. He said, there is no رقية except from عين أو حمى. عين يعني the evil eye, أو حمى يعني being ill. And from amongst that comes under being stung. قال, قد أحسن من انتهى إلى ما سمع. You've done good because you got a hadith for what you've done. ولكن حدثنا ابن عباس. But he said, Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما, he told me a hadith. عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, قال, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, عرضت علي الأمم. All of the nations, they were presented to me. يعني the nation of Musa, of Isa, children of Israel, they were all presented to me. فرأيت النبي ومعه الرهب. So I saw a prophet, and with him was a group of people. يعني he had a small group of followers. والنبي ومعه الرجل والرجلان. And I saw another prophet, and with him is only a man or two men, one man or two men. يعني he only had two followers. All of his da'wah, he only gained two followers, one of these prophets. والنبي وليس معه أحد. And I saw a prophet, and there was no one with him. He was alone. No one responded to his call. What benefit does it give us? A person who gives da'wah to the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it doesn't matter how many people are following him. It's just about what he's calling to. If he's calling to the truth, then it's not going to harm him if he's not following. Because some of the prophets, they were not even following, as you see here. إِذْ رُفِعَ لِي سَوَادٌ عَظِيمٌ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, and so a huge nation, a huge group of people, they were presented in front of me. فَظَنَنْتُ أَنَّهُمْ أُمَّتِي. And I thought that was my ummah. فَقِيلَ لِي, it was said to me, هَذَا مُوسَى وَقَوْمُهُ. This is Musa and his people. This is Musa's ummah, the ummah of Musa. فَنَظَرْتُ فَإِذَا سَوَادٌ عَظِيمٌ. And so I looked again in another place, and I saw an even bigger group. فقيل لي, and it was said to me, هذه أمتك, this is your أمة. ومعهم 70,000 يدخلون الجنة بغير حساب ولا عذاب. And with them are 70,000 people. 70,000 people amongst this أمة, they will enter into Jannah بغير حساب ولا عذاب. They will enter into Jannah without any accountability and no punishment. 70,000. No accountability, no punishment. Straight to Jannah. On Day of Judgment, straight into Jannah. جعلنا الله منهم. ثم نهض فدخل منزله. So then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he went and he entered into his house. فخاض الناس في أولئك. So the people, they started speaking about, who are those people? 70,000 people entered into Jannah without any accountability. فقال بعضهم, Some of the companions, they said, فَلَعَلَّهُمُ الَّذِينَ صَحِبُوا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Maybe they're going to be the companions. These 70,000 are only going to be the companions. وَقَالَ بَعْضُهُمْ. And some of them, they said, فَلَعَلَّهُمُ الَّذِينَ وُلِدُوا فِي الْإِسْلَامِ وَلَمْ يُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ شَيْئًا. Maybe they're going to be the people who were born in Islam, and they never done shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that shows how big tawheed, the companions, how much they understood what tawheed is. Because they understand how that maybe these people, they're such a, يعني, they have such a virtue. Then he said, وَذَكَرُوا أَشْيَاءَ. And so they mentioned many different things. Start guessing. فَخَرَجَ عَلَيْهِمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. And so the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he came out amongst them. فَأَخْبَرُوهُ. And so they told him that the people were talking. They're saying, who are these people? 70,000 people going to enter Jannah without any accountability. Any hisab or adab or punishment. فَقَالَ. He said, هُمُ الَّذِينَ لَا يَسْتَرْقُونَ وَلَا يَكْتَوُونَ وَلَا يَتَطَيَّرُونَ وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. They are those people who لا يستغفون. They do not seek ruqya from other people. Yani they don't go to other people and say, do ruqya on me. It's not haram, talawat. But they don't seek that. وَلَا يَكْتَوُونَ. And they do not do cauterization, which is a type of medicine which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. He said that what they do is they stop the blood, they burn the vein to stop the blood in order to heal people. And this medicine till today is used. It's not hijama. It's used till today. And it is, according to some scholars, mubah, allow. And some say it's makruh, dislike. Naam. Wallahu a'lam. So this is another thing. And I'll tell you why. Why is it these two things? ولا يتطيرون. And they do not have evil omens. They don't believe in superstition. يعني, for example, if you walk on a crack and stuff like that, walking on a crack is bad luck and stuff like that. The rate, if you see a black crow, bad luck. All these kind of charms and all these rubbish. Okay. وعلى ربهم يتوكلون. And they only have tawakkul in Allah. They only trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the people that can be done without any accountability or any punishment. What do they have in common? These people, all of them. They all had tawakkul in Allah. How? Ahsan, barakallahu feek. They only relied on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the pinnacle of tawheed. They never relied on anything other than Allah. For example, look, ruqya. You're allowed to do ruqya on yourself. But don't you see that? And by the way, doing ruqya on yourself, it doesn't come under this hadith. And you still be, inshallah, 70,000 people. You can be, but asking others for ruqya. Don't you see that when you ask others for ruqya, why did you ask someone else for ruqya? Because you thought that person had something that he could do for you. He could help you in a way that you can't help yourself, for example. Right? You thought this person can help you in a way that you can't help yourself. Right? You're this person more righteous than me. So what happened there? Your heart was attached slightly to other than Allah. That's that person. It wasn't haram. It's allowed. But your heart, no, the part of completion, actualizing of tawheed, which is our chapter heading, part of actualizing the tawheed of Allah is that you have nothing, no connection, nothing to other than Allah. Right? That's why some of the companions, they gave bay'ah to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And from the conditions of the bay'ah, they said, وَأَلَّا نَسْأَلَ النَّاسَ شَيْئًا. We don't ask the people for anything. So one of the companions, when his whip would fall on the floor, he was on his horse, and his whip would fall on the floor, he wouldn't ask someone to get it from him. He'll get down and get it himself and get back up. So he doesn't want any connection with other than Allah. And so we're going to see, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, مَنْ صَنَعَ إِلَيْكُمْ مَعْرُوفًا فَكَافِئُوهُ. If someone does good to you, then give it back to him. Someone gives you something, get something else. Someone gives you, and he gives you a drink, go next day, give him a drink as well. If you can't do that, and he gave you a car, he gave you a house, can't get it back, you can't give him something same. Obviously, you don't want to give the gift back, but you're not rich enough to get something, give something back. What do you do? فَدْعُوا لَهُ مِكْ دُعَا فَهَمْ. حَتَّى تَظُنُّونَ أَنَّكُمْ قَدْ كَافَأْتُمُهُ. Until you think that you've done similar things. Why? So that your heart is not connected to him. And you don't feel indebted to that person. Only feel indebted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? That's the part of the completion of the tawheed of Allah. You get it? So these people, these 70,000 people, يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةَ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ وَلَا عَذَابٍ. لا يسترقون. They don't seek ruqya from other people. وَلَا يَكْتَوُونَ. They don't do kay. Why kay? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he prohibited it. That's why. He prohibited it. He said the He said, the medicine, meaning the cure in my ummah, is in hijama, hijama, and also this al-kay, or na'am, cauterization. Right? But he said, وَلَكِنِّي أَنْهَاكُمْ عَنْ ذَلِكَ But I prohibit you from doing the cauterization. I prohibit you from doing that. But it's allowed. It's a prohibition that is not for, it doesn't show with haram. Some say it's prohibition and then it became lifted, يعني. Or some say it's lil-karaha, it's makruh, it's disliked. It's better not to do it. But the point is, the Prophet ﷺ prohibited it. Therefore, we stay away from it. And a person who thinks that there's cure in it, and he's ill, and he thinks the only way that I'm going to be cured is by this thing, then know that he should have tawakkul in Allah. Maybe Allah will cure you through another means. Right? Or maybe Allah will cure you. And that shows that a person is only having trust in Allah. وَلَا يَتَطَيَّرُونَ He's not believing evil omens. يعني you think that this rose that you have is going to give you, is going to bring you good luck. Or that blue charm that they have, the eye. That Turkish thing that they have, the brother from Turkey, they have it, the eye. That it protects you from the evil eye. You're believing in a protection. It can't protect you from anything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who protects. So the one who believes in these things, he believes in these evil omens. That if your shoe, among some people, some our culture, is that when the shoe is upside down, it's disrespect, you're going to have bad luck and things like that. Amongst a lot of Muslim cultures, and obviously in the UK they have different, or the West, they have different things like charms and all that stuff. And the Muslim cultures also have these kind of things, like what? When your eye twitches, what is it? I know, I forgot that one. What is that? You forgot something. When you're talking about someone and you enter into the room, it means you're going to have good luck. That person's going to have good luck. It's part of our culture, some of our cultures. Or if you're...
Or they've got them two poles.
Huh?
They only walk with them two poles.
Yeah, it sounds like that. That's the UK culture. I'm talking about Muslim culture. Muslims, we have Muslim stuff. Huh?
You mentioned
No, no, he didn't say it's only in hijama and that. He said these are two things that cure.
Is medicine, is that medicine?
No, medicine is allowed. Medicine is allowed. Yeah, I'm taking a medicine is allowed. No, it doesn't. No, medicine doesn't. Medicine doesn't come under taking paracetamol. That doesn't come under it. This is specifically to cauterization and seeking ruqyah. As for medicine, paracetamol, all that stuff is allowed. It's okay. Yeah?
Somewhere else that
is
not to believe in good omens but to take good from, I don't know.
That's something we're going to come to, inshallah, which is that to believe in omens, it has two different, it has stages, which means that if you believe that something bad is going to happen to you because you saw something, then, or you're going to do something before because that you saw something, that's what's not allowed. As what you're doing something, and you hear, for example, you go to a transaction, you're going to a business deal, and you hear someone say, today I'm going to make a lot of profit. You know, I'm making a business deal, I'm going to make a lot. That is called at-tafa'ul in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. It's allowed. That's allowed. You say, okay, alhamdulillah, it's going to encourage me to do this business deal. Maybe this is a good sign from Allah. That's something that's allowed. That's not bad omen. But that's not omen. Omen is something that makes you do something. Yeah, you come out of your house, you see a black crow, you say, I'm going to bad that and go back home. Understand? Or you see a crack on the floor, I'm not going to step in it because something bad might happen to me. Understand? As for this one, then you don't believe that person who said, I'm going to have a prophet today, he's the one who makes you have a prophet. No. You believe it's from Allah, but it's a sign from Allah. But these things, they're not signs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah said, these are not signs. Okay? Yeah, Muhammad.
You expand on prophet, that
you might not have, but could you expand on the cauterization? Yeah, cauterization. I said it, is that the Prophet prohibited it. He prohibited it there, and he said it's a medicine, but he prohibited it. And the reason why, because we submit to the Prophet ﷺ. The one who submits to the Prophet ﷺ is going to submit to that and never do it, because the Prophet ﷺ prohibited it, even though it's allowed. Even though it's allowed. You get it? Barakallahu feekum. طيب. ولا يتطيرون. Omens. You get it? Omens. يعني you don't believe in these kind of charms. What's another one? There's so many. And what's another one among Muslim culture? Black cat. Man. But I'm trying to look for Muslim culture, no? If your hands itch, what's that one? You're going to make money, something like that. Huh? They have that kind of stuff. A lot of cultures, Somali culture, you have it, Pakistani culture, I'm sure you guys have it. A lot of people have it. They have these kind of things. طيب. All of this is part of the tayyur, it's not allowed. وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ أَلَىٰ اللَّهُ Only upon Allah they have their trust. They only have their trust in Allah. None of these omens. فَقَامَ عُكَّاشَ A man called عُكَّاشَ ibn Muhsan, who was a man from the people of Badr. He was in the part of the battle of Badr. فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ He said, O Messenger of Allah, أدعو الله أن يجعلني منهم. Call upon Allah, make dua to Allah to make me from amongst those people. فقال أنت منهم. He said, you're from amongst them. يعني عكاشة is from amongst those 70,000 people. That's 69,999 left. ثم قام رجل آخر. Another man stood up. And he said, أدعو الله أن يجعلني منهم. O messenger of Allah, ask Allah to make me from amongst them. فقال the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, سبقك بها عكاشة. عكاشة beat you to it. يعني he doesn't want everyone to come and keep asking. طيب. In another authentic narration from the same hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and with every one, with every person from amongst these 70,000, there will be another 70,000. And with every 70,000, there will be another 70,000. Another hadith, there will be pushes. Allah, and Allah will push people amongst these 70,000 extra people with Allah's hand. He'll push and he'll push and he'll push. Yani there'll be extra and extra and extra. Yani meaning, it's not only the companions, it's only those people from the early generations. Rather, it can be one of us, because there's millions and millions of people, inshallah, who's going to be from amongst them. But originally, it's 70,000. And added to that, in the Muslim, the other hadith which came, which show another extra group of people who also be from amongst those people, who be 70,000, who enter into Jannah without any accountability or any punishment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from amongst them. Ameen. Question?
70,000.
See, when the
aims are
holding 70,000, I heard that
70,000
added
is like an infinite number in Arabic language.
But
is that 70,000 specific as in that number
70,000, or is it? Nah. You're right. A lot of times, not all the time though. A lot of times, that number 70,000 or 7 or 70, يعني استغفر لهم أو لا تستغفر لهم. If you ask Allah to forgive them 70 مرة, لن يغفر الله لهم. Allah 70 times, Allah will never forgive them. So it means يعني infinite. صح. لكن in this case, it's specific. And the Prophet, because why? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, with them, with each one of them is another 70,000. And he mentioned another Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that with them there will be extra people. You understand? So this one is specific. And it's a mas'ala, a good mas'ala. It's a good question. They have it in usul al-fiqh, they ask that question. Now, طيب, let's go through the mas'ala and then we'll end it, inshallah. Al-ula, ma'rifatu marat, this is the last evidence, huh? Ma'rifatu maratib al-nasi fi al-tawheed. That people's levels in tawheed are different. Not everyone's the same in their tawheed. Some people have more tawakkul in Allah, and some people have less. And the one who actualizes tawheed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's the one who enters into Jannah without any accountability or any punishment. ما معنى تحقيقه? What's the meaning of تحقيق of tawheed? Actualizing tawheed? Say again? نعم, صح. You're right. MashaAllah. It's the oneness of Allah. What's the other meaning of actualizing tawheed? تقريبا what did I say at the beginning? What is it?
Staying away from shirk, staying away from bid'ah and sins.
Staying away from shirk, staying away from bid'ah, staying away from sins. And the one who sins, he repents from it to Allah. نعم. الثالثة ثناؤه سبحانه على إبراهيم بكونه لم يكن من المشركين. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised Ibrahim because he was not from the mushrikeen. الرابعة ثناؤه على سادات الأولياء بسلامته من الشرك. That he praised the أولياء of Allah, friends of Allah, because they weren't the people of shirk. الخامسة, number 5 is كون ترك الرقية والكي من تحقيق التوحيد. Don't leaving off seeking رقية and leaving off الكي is part of actualizing توحيد. السادسة كون الجامع لتلك الخصال هو التوكل. That the common factor between these all attributes is توكل. You trust in Allah alone. حتى the companions, they won't ask the people things as we mentioned, right? نعم. السابعة عمق علم الصحابة لمعرفتهم أنهم لم ينالوا ذلك إلا بعمل. The deep understanding of the Sahaba, that they would understand that they were never going to get to that except by their actions. And they didn't believe, they said, oh, wait, just because we say La ilaha illallah and we're companions, we're going to get to that. No. So there were people who never done shirk with Allah. And they were asking, who are they? Understand? الثامنة حرصهم على الخير. That the Sahaba, they were really eager to get to good. And if there's anyone who is going to do something that's good, then the Sahaba definitely done it. So if you find that the Sahaba never done something, then know that it wasn't good. Because you're not more eager than the companion, than the Sahabi, the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to do good. They were the most eager people to do good. Therefore, if they didn't do it, then it's not good. And tasi'a, number 9, فضيلة هذه الأمة بالكمية والكيفية. The virtue of this ummah, in terms of how many we are the most, the largest ummah, and also بالكيفية in how, يعني,
quality as well, quantity and quality. يعني العاشرة فضيلة أصحاب موسى, the virtue of the companions of Musa. الحادية عشرة عرض الأمم عليه السلام, عليه الصلاة والسلام, the relations they were presented to the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. الثامنة عشرة 18 أن كل أمة every أمة تحشر وحدها مع نبيها. They will be every ummah, every nation, they will be resurrected and they will be gathered together with their prophet. الثالثة عشرة 13 قلة من استجاب للأنبياء, how little of the people they responded to the prophet. So don't be scared and don't be sad that the fact that you're upon the path of the truth by yourself, because know the companions or the companions of good and the people who responded to the prophets, they were very little as well. So don't be sad. Ibn al-Qayyim رحمه الله تعالى, he said, when you feel lonely upon the path of istiqamah, of practicing the deen of Allah, you feel lonely on that path, then he said, then look at those people who took that path before you, from the prophets and the martyrs and the righteous people and the truthful. Look at those people who came before you on that path. You might feel lonely today. You find no one in your areas practicing. Everyone's leaving and everyone's doing bad and evil. Then know that even if you're by yourself, know that remember those people who came before you. You're on that path. You're on the path of the prophets. You're not on any other path. أن من لم يجبه أحد يأتي وحده. If there's a question from the sisters, pass on please, inshallah. الثالثة عشرة 13 قلة من استجاب للأنبياء. How little of the people they responded to the prophets. الرابعة عشرة 14 is أن من لم يجبه أحد يأتي وحده. Whoever's not responded to alone, whoever's not responded to, meaning from the prophets, he will be resurrected alone. No one with him. خامسة عشرة ثمرة هذا العلم وهو عدم الاغترار بالكثرة وعدم الزهد في القلة. Look at this, huh? He says the fruit of this, of knowing this, which is don't be deceived by a large amount of people. Just because people, they're large amount, it doesn't mean that they're upon the truth. And do not be وعدم الزهد في القلة. Do not يعني lose care in those people who are little. Even if you have one person with you, take care of that person, teach them. Because that one person, maybe he's going to go on and teach nations. Right? Al-Imam Nafi' Mawla ibn Umar. Do you guys know Nafi'? You guys know Nafi' is? Nafi' Mawla ibn Umar. He was Imam Malik's teacher. Nah, sent. He used to sit. He was the freed slave of Ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu. He used to sit in the Masjid al-Nabawi. And he would sit after Fajr and teach. And no one would sit with him except for Imam Malik at that time, sometimes, many times. And so what happened? Did he leave? Did he say, no, forget this, only one person, what am I going to benefit? No, what happened? He taught Imam Malik. And what happened? If you go to the Muwatta of Imam Malik, the book of Imam Malik, what do you see? قال المالك قال حدثنا نافع عن ابن عمر عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. That chain of narration. And they say it's the strongest chain of narration, some of them they say, right? So imagine my Nafi', imagine he's left off that one person. And now look at the deeds that he's going to get. If you look at Bukhari, Sahih Bukhari, he has a chain of narration. He goes, حدثنا عبد الله بن مسلمة. Bukhari says, حدثنا عبد الله بن مسلمة. قال حدثنا مالك عن نافع عن ابن عمر. He brings at least 50 times in his book. In Sahih Bukhari that we read until today. Nafi', imagine he left. He didn't leave. So that shows that you don't know what good deeds you're going to get, even if you don't see it. Even if you don't see it until later on in your life, even sometimes you won't even see it until after you die. You see on the Day of Judgment. Look at Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala. At his time he was in prison. He had students, but his works were never ever looked after and taken care of for a long time properly, except by the Hanabila, until he came Sheikh Abd al-Rahman al-Qasim and those scholars of Saudi, and they came and they gathered his works. And today you see Ibn Taymiyyah's works are everywhere. Today, yani, in the past 100 years it came out like that. Before that, it was just the Hanabila who had his works properly. They would look after his works. But today, everyone has his works. Why? Because it's something that he had between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He didn't leave off because the people left him. Because he was in prison, because he was beaten, tortured. He didn't leave it off. طيب. No question? الرخصة في الرقية من العين والحمى. You're allowed to do رقية from عين, evil eye, and حمى. نعم. السابعة عشرة 17 is عمق علم السلف لقوله قد أحسن من انتهى إلى ما سمع ولكن كذا وكذا. The Salaf, they had deep knowledge, because he didn't say that's your hadith. No, he said good, you had a hadith, you acted by your hadith, that's a good thing. ف فعلم أن الحديث الأول لا يخالف الثاني. doesn't go against the second hadith that he mentioned. 18. بعد السلف عن مدح الإنسان بما ليس فيه. The Salaf, they would never praise someone with something that they never had. 19. قوله أن يعني the man, he said, I wasn't praying. In case he thinks, يعني you're awake at night, you saw the star, oh, you must have been praying. But no, I wasn't praying. He was honest with himself. طيب 18. بعد نعم 19. قوله أنت منهم علم من أعلام النبوة. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Ukasha that he's from the people of Jannah. That shows he's a prophet. And 20 فضيلة عكاشة, the virtue of عكاشة. 21 is استعمال المعاريض. You're allowed to use معاريض. يعني, without saying no, you're not one of them. What the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said? Say, سبقك بها عكاشة. عكاشة beat you to it. To be nice, you're allowed to use معاريض like that. Then حسن خل. It says there. And the 22nd one is the good manners of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the next bab is fourth from the shirk. We'll take it inshallah ta'ala next lesson bi-idhnillah ta'ala. We'll carry on after this lesson. This lesson, especially next lesson as well, this chapter al-khawf min al-shirk, it actually is, again, it's still just introduction to the book. When we're going to get into the actual masail of what's haram and halal and things like that, it's coming soon. So inshallah ta'ala, we'll go slowly. Whenever I stop and I say write it down, that's when it's a point that you need. If I'm saying it fast, then don't worry, listen. If you get it, you get it inshallah. If you don't, then listen to the recording. It's not something that is a point that you need to, yani, a concept that you have to understand. Okay, so I have a way to do that. When I stop and slowly write it down and listen and focus on what I'm saying. If I don't say it slowly, if I'm what's it called, going fast, then just understand that, and you can listen to it, and you don't have to write down. If it misses you, you don't have to write everything down. A good student of knowledge doesn't write anything, everything down. He writes what he needs down.